Okay, so there's a few things I've realized when doing this vlog. Sometimes I get too busy with work to take time to do the vlog at all. And now that's a good thing, obviously. The vlog is a personal thing, and work is work, and that's what pays the bills. But I like doing this vlog because it does enhance my life. I do a lot more interesting things, I feel like. When I'm on the fence about doing something, I think that'll be good for the vlog, and then I will get out and do it. Whereas sometimes I'd feel like, I don't know if I want to go through the trouble of getting ready and, doing all the things. But today, since I have this program called the Icon Engineering System. I help authors and entrepreneurs sort of market themselves in a heightened way so that they stand out in their market. And the part I was working on today was origin stories and teaching them how to develop their own origin stories. Not develop them, tell their personal origin stories in the way that can best showcase them. And so I thought today, since I ran out of time, I would just go through some of my own that I'm showcasing to other people so they can see my personal journey. And so I have on my personal Facebook, I keep my origin stories just so anybody can see them, but then I also use them in marketing material. So this is the first one. That's a photo of me, and the face is painted, but painted with Photoshop. But it's a long story, but I'll link to the origin story so you can read them all. But you'll start to get a you'll start to notice a pattern, how I start my origin stories. Like this one starts 10 years ago. I enlisted into the Navy under the SEAL Challenge program. And then I put this 100% true story of what happened next. It'll take roughly 10 to 11 minutes to read. That way people can know that, okay, this is a true story. It's serious enough that it's going to take 11 minutes on Facebook. And then I say, at the time I was making between $30,000 to $50,000 profit per month selling Iraqi dinar to investors who hoped the currency would again become valuable, etc., etc. And so you'll notice there, I started off 10 years ago. Right, and then obviously the topic is highly compelling. That part of my past is a fun story for people to read, but it was often hard to live it. And so you can read it and comment if you like. Here is one about my ISIS business, my Iraqi stock investing system. So it starts out at 26 years old. I sat in Kenosha, Wisconsin, waiting for the FBI agent to arrive. He said he'd be there at 9 a.m. He was, exactly. That was a scary morning for me. It was. Since I had recently begun importing Iraqi dinar into the U.S., I didn't yet know if what I was doing was legal. That was true, and I was scared. And I said it was my repeated $20,000 wire transfers to a bank in Amman, Jordan, that tipped them off that something may be amiss. And so that was a highly unusual day, but you'll see that I started off with a number again, so people can get an idea. Oh, he was 26. He was the FBI agent was going to arrive. Holy cow! And I put the location, so right away it sets up in people's minds a story, and then they want to know that story. And then I said he'd be there at 9 a.m. He was exactly. Which just confirms that you'd think an FBI agent would be prompt, and he was. And then I go on to say, fortunately, after an hour of him sheepishly scanning the room, analyzing my book collection, observing my personal mannerisms, and asking questions to learn exactly what I was doing, he determined I was within the law, U.S. law anyway, and it turned into a recruiting session. And that's true. Again, you can read that one. But you'll notice patterns here. Now this is. From a newspaper, obviously, when I won my second state title. And again, I tell the year, turn back time. This is June of 1995. Front page photo of me in the Eau Claire Leader Telegram, rounding the turn with 200 meters to go in the 1600 meters, which is essentially the mile 1609 meters. At the 1995 Wisconsin State Track and Field Championships, this gave me my second state championship in as many days after winning the 3200 meters. And so again, you can see I'm putting figures in there so people can wrap their head around it and think, "Ooh, I get this story. I understand this," and they want to read more. So I'm not sure who's viewing this, but I suspect there'll be enough people viewing it who maybe entrepreneurs are thinking about it, thinking about branding yourself on Instagram, YouTube, Facebook, wherever. And the origin stories help people connect to you so that they see you as a person and not just a figment on the internet that they may not care about. If you can get people to bond to your story, they will follow you and they'll have an emotional investment in you. This is me back in college. So this is back in college when I was an eBay power seller taken in 1999 or 2000. I can't remember when it was exactly. I was bringing in $2,000 a week selling Ginsu knives, watches, diet pills, and golf instruction videos. And so I sold this stuff called Snorens. It was a spray and it was supposed to prevent snoring. I don't know if it actually worked that well because I couldn't tell on myself, you know. But some people said it worked and others said it did nothing. So I have no idea. But I would have these cheesy auctions that would say, I learned that selling to the wives was better than selling to the men, because the men didn't think it was a problem. The women thought it was a problem that their man was snoring. And so I would phrase it, big headline, like, does your husband sound like a chainsaw at night? Is your husband louder than a Harley Davidson when he sleeps? Things like that to elicit a laugh and also make the wife think, yeah, he is, and I need to solve it, and I'll spend $6 to see if it works or not. And so, I mean, I sold a lot of those things. That was a good time. It was when eBay was quite new, and I was one of the initial power sellers, and it was a good start to my entrepreneurial development. This here, but again, though, I used figures. I used the year, and then I used $2,000 a week to give, you know, to bring people in. This one is my brother Joe. It says, this is my brother Joe over 10 years ago as Grand Marshal of our 4th of July parade after he won the 2 mile at the state track championships. And so I had, and then our coach Knickerbocker's in the passenger seat. So I had rented this Dodge Viper for the day so that Joe could be taken through the parade in style as the Grand Marshal. I had been Grand Marshal 5 years prior, and so it was a nice thing that my brother also won the state title. It was a really proud moment. This is here, just me jumping over a picnic table. But, you know, putting in some younger moments in your life helps as well, because then people... Here's what happens. Once you achieve some success in life, people will start thinking, man, that kid must have been born fortunate, right? Or had parents with money or something like that. And so I've realized I wasn't, and I'll show you a photo coming up soon. We were born very poor. And so I think it's worth showcasing that stuff so people can see the human side of you and the journey from here to here or wherever you are on the scale. And so the things that show that you were a kid with determination and gumption and who became an adult with the same determination and gumption helps people identify with you, like you, respect you, and trust you. This is the one I was going to. That's me in an outhouse. That's the only bathroom we had at the time, so that's what I say. I'll read this whole thing. This is me as a young boy going to the bathroom in the only bathroom we had. There's a notion in psychology called the overprediction of fear, which is that most of us overestimate just how terrifying certain experiences can be. I grew up quite poor. We didn't have an indoor bathroom. We had this outhouse. That's true. But I didn't know we were poor. I was always loved, read to constantly, taken for walks, and taught that I could become whatever I set my mind to. I'd hang out with my pet raccoons, true, journey through the northern Wisconsin woods, ride my bike, and read. Since my mother had to work 2 to 3 jobs, my grandpa and grandma took on the task of doing much of the raising of me. My grandpa read constantly, so it became a lifelong habit of mine. I'd escape into books to learn about worlds vastly different from my own. Later, since I lacked social skills, I'd use books to escape having to talk to people. I realized early that people tend not to bother a kid who's reading. That's true. All of this was a perfect way to be raised from my perspective. I didn't know any better. As a kid, I was never as fearful of the situations that many kids were, and now many adults are. I know what it's like to be poor, and I know what it's like to lose money after having had money now as well. And it wasn't a big deal. I know what it's like to be alone, to be cold, and to learn to handle situations on my own. And because of the lack of fear of typical societal issues, I'm now allowed free range to try unusual ideas, because I'm not afraid of the consequences of failure. It's not that bad. That's true. Failure isn't that bad. I mean, maybe you feel a little like... Well, the sense of failure can bring a little bit of humiliation, but I can't remember the last time I felt that. I think after the first couple times of you trying something and failing, you realize, oh, I'm just working towards my goal. And obviously it's not going to go from idea to fully realized goal in one step. It's going to take a lot of steps. And so you get over it real quick. You just have to have the courage to start. You know, some people never start. And so they always think they always live in that fear rather than realizing, oh, it's not that bad at all. But I've got a slew of these, and so if you want to see them, you can. If you don't care, that's fine too. But this allowed me to sort of do double duty, do my work, and also I thought maybe it would be helpful to some people who may be watching this. So, end of vlog.